Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Michelle Arthur. I'm a member of the Peace and Love Domino's Club, of which Philip was the more recent member. I can't say that I've known him for a long time, but what he brought to our club and to the Domino fraternity is a wealth of knowledge, support, and advice. Whatever Philip put his mind to, he got done. He was the person that you could depend on at the very last set to bring home the win for whatever team he was playing for. In addition to that, he acted as a father figure to many of us. Sometimes it was difficult to understand where he was coming from because of his manner, but he always meant well. And in his final days, what he taught all of us, and me especially, is about the love of God and his faith, which kept him going right up until the end. Even in illness, his last talk to us was to thank us for our friendship and to tell us to enjoy Domino's. And we have tried at every opportunity to remember him. I think that it would be fitting of all of us to remember how strong he was in faith, if we take away nothing else, and to remember that God is good. It might seem like we're sad because we've lost him, but he's left us with a wonderful memory of what a true teammate should be, what a loving father should be, what a supportive husband should be, and what a Christian should be. We will miss him, but we know he is resting in peace. Thank you.
I want to thank Michelle for her sharing. Perchance anybody doesn't need to say anything, you need to say it now. But once the service begins and you're not in the service, you cannot be included at that time. Thank you and I love you. Thank you.
driver of X169, please remove your vehicle. The driver of X169. God must need another angel around the throne tonight. Your love lives on inside of me, and I will hold on tight. It's not my place to question, only God knows why. I'm just with the driver of X169, please remove your vehicle. With the driver of X169, please remove your vehicle. I know. So I'll hold you as close as I can, longing for the day when I see your face again. But until then, God must need another angel around the throne tonight. Your love lives on inside of me, and I will hold on tight. It's not my place to question, only God knows why. I'm just jealous of the angels around the the throne tonight, singing hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. I'm just jealous of the angels around the throne tonight. Didn't know today would be your last, or that I'd have to say goodbye to you so fast. I'm so numb, I can't feel anymore. I'm praying you just walk. Eternal
God is our refuge, and underneath us everlasting arms. Would you stand with me as we do our procession? I shall read partway, and then you will kick in with the singing of the first song, You Are God Alone, making a statement here this afternoon on behalf of the late Philip Nathaniel Eswick. Listen, I tell you a mystery. Not all sleep, but we'll all be changed in a flash. In the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet. For the trumpet will sound, and the dead will be raised imperishable, and we will be changed. Then the saying that is written will come true. Death has been swallowed up in victory. O death, where's your sting? O grave, where's your victory? The sting of death is sin, and the strength of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, who gave us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, my dear brothers and sisters, stand firm. Let nothing move you. Always give yourself fully to the work of the Lord, because you know that your labor in the Lord is not in vain. You are God alone. Let's sing to the glory of God. Just praise the Lord and worship Him this afternoon.
God created.
the good times and in the bad times, he's still God.
Bless the name of the Lord. May I now say a blessed good afternoon to everyone. Good afternoon to everyone. Despite the pain of the loss of the late Philip Nathaniel Eswit, we are here yet to celebrate his life and his love of the Lord and his love of dominoes, among other things, and certainly a good man in many forms, in many ways. Not a perfect man, of course, but a good man. And that's why you're here. This is testimony of the fact that in some way he would have touched your lives, whether it was in a good argument, as he liked to at times, or a good debate, as it might be, or he's just trying to help you to see the right way in his own inimitable style. Thank God for him, and we will miss him, of course. The impact he's left on us will remain, I believe, and the legacy will be carried on in the faith of the Lord Jesus Christ. So again, good afternoon to you. And for the family at this time, we join you in your heartache, in your tears, in your sadness, and your pain, to offer ourselves, of our hands, our hearts, or every part, for that matter, to be a source of blessing, encouragement, and strength to you as you face life without the late Philip Nathaniel Eswit. Dearly beloved, we are gathered today to pay our final tribute of respect to that which was mortal of our deceased loved one and friend. To you, members of the family who mourn your loss, we especially offer our deep and indeed our sincere sympathy. And may we share with you the comfort afforded by God's word for such a time, hour, and a day like this. In the words of Jesus Christ, as written in the New International Version, do not let your hearts be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many rooms, or the King James will say mansions, or other versions will say dwelling places. If it were not so, I would have told you, I'm going there to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to be unto myself, that where I am, there you may be also. In like manner, he goes on to say in the same book of John, but further earlier chapters, I'm the resurrection and the life. The one who believes in me will live, even though they die. And whoever lives by believing in me will never die. So that we can truly say, Philip lives. He is with the Lord. And further words from the Apostle, let me go back from the Apostle Paul and take Job and then the Apostle Paul. I know that my Redeemer lives and that in the end he will stand on the earth. And after my skin has been destroyed, yet in my flesh I will see God. I myself will see him with my own eyes. I and not another, how my heart yearns within me. And of course, this is the New International Version. And final words again from the Apostle Paul, which I would have probably read a bit before as well. When this corruptible shall have put on corruption, and this mortal shall have put on immortality, then shall be brought to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is thy sting? O grave, where is thy victory? The sting of death is sin, and the strength of sin is the law. But thanks be to God who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Let the people say amen. 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 The other scriptures that come, we'll talk about comfort one another with these words. And so we take that time to do so this evening. But David Curtin, who would have succeeded Brother Philip Eswit as the man's special president, is going to come and lead us in the next hymn. I need no other argument. I need no other plea. And while I'm saying it, the song in your program, Mark, Sovereign Lord, is not what we requested. And so you're going to take it through the PowerPoint and multimedia when that song is at the time. Okay.
Fast from the resting place, not in device nor creed. I trust the ever-living one, his wounds for me shall plead. I need no other argument. Stop.
Jesus died and that he died for me, all of us, thank God, and we can all be saved through repentance and faith in Jesus Christ. You still have to claim your spot. He might have died for you, but you still got to claim your spot by repentance and faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. On the following page is Psalm 46. We're going to read it together as a crowd, as a congregation. We read together. When you get in the mirror, you say, the Lord of hosts, somehow lift the tempo a little higher. The volume, because that's like a refrain, and we do it at the end as well. So let's read together from the 46th Psalm in the King James Version, or generally as it will be. Let's read. God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Therefore will not we fear, though the earth be removed, and though the mountains be carried into the midst of the sea, though the waters thereof roar and be troubled, though the mountains shake with the swelling thereof, there is a river. The stream whereof shall make glad the city of God, the holy place of the tabernacles of the Most High. God is in the midst of her. She shall not be moved. God shall help her, and that right early. The heathen raged. The kingdoms were moved. He uttered his voice. The earth melted together. One. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our refuge. Continue. Come, behold the works of the Lord. What desolations he have made in the earth. He maketh wars to cease unto the end of the earth. He breaketh the bow and cutteth the spear in sunder. He burneth the chariot in the fire. Be still and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the heathen. I'll be exalted in the earth. And together one more time, the Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our refuge. Let the people say amen. Amen. This is the word of God, the inspired word, and we believe it to be just that, the word of God. I'm going to invite us, the family that is, to come around this casket, family members only at this time. Would you come around this casket, Diana and all others, to say farewell to prayer. We want to pray for you. I want to ask Brother Springer, if you don't mind, sir, I will ask you to do the family prayer for the family and for all of us. Just come around the casket. Yeah, all right. Side and front, not the back of it. Brother Springer? Brother Springer? Could you raise the last verse of the song? Multimedia, could you help us with that, please? The great physician is our Lord. My great physician, he is the sick, the lost, he came to save.
position is the set. The loss he came to set. For me is precious blood he shed. For
just before I left home, I was thinking about Philip.
Put the mic up to your mouth, please. Put the mic to your mouth. Put the mic to your mouth. Put the mic to the mouth.
Just before I left home, I was laying on my bed and I was thinking about Philip and the clothes I was wearing, a black suit. And I thought of Philip in heaven. Here we are, dressed in black, in mourning colors. But the reality is that Philip is in heaven, dressed differently, in a white robe, pure white robe. And I think we should think of Philip at this time and rejoice with him, because God is so good. Let us pray. Eternal God and a righteous Heavenly Father, creator of all things, visible and invisible, you thought of us before you created us, even the very ends. And we give you thanks and we give you praise because you send your son, Jesus Christ, in this world to die and pay the penalty for our sins. And we are thankful, Father, that today we can say that Philip's sins has been paid in everyone who would come to him, because you said that he that cometh unto me, I will in no wise cast out. And we thank you for your words, Lord. And we pray now, Lord, as we are on this side, are grieving, because we have lost someone. We pray, oh Father, in the name of Jesus Christ, that you will strengthen, Lord, especially the family of Phillips, Diane, and all those around, his sons and daughters, his cousins, all those around here tonight. We pray, oh Father, that you will touch them and comfort them with the realization that Philip is in a better place. Today he is rejoicing. I believe that the angels are escorting him all through heaven. And he is enjoying a beautiful place, a place that he could not have imagined of. We give you thanks, Lord, and we give you praise. We pray, O Father, that you will strengthen each one today. Strengthen each one today. And help us to always remember what Philip would be saying at this time. Where would you rather me be? And we pray, O Father, that we will rejoice today with him, even as he's rejoicing. Help us, O Lord, to be comforted, for we pray in Jesus' name. Amen and amen.
Let me all sit. Thank you for the spur. He was a good friend of Philip. Many times they were in their debates, arguments. but there's always a friendly banter between the two of them. And I'm sure Brother Springer will miss Brother Philip, as the case is. But he's gone. We now have to go to him. He's not coming back to us, as David would say. And truly, that is the word of the Lord. Also, I'm going to invite Mr. Billboard Murrell and, of course, Chas Holdick Clement. Both of you who come close by. They're going to be, at this time, making their contribution to the service. Eulogy and clarinet special by Chance, who happens to be the stepson of the late Philip.
Good afternoon, everyone. First, let me say that I don't know about y'all, but today is not a day of despair for me, because I know Philip and I know where Philip is, and we should be rejoicing with those that rejoice. That's what the Bible says. You know, you die in Christ, you're good to go. So today I have the task of doing the eulogy for my good friend Philip. Now, some persons may ask, well, how was such a young man like you, young enough to be Philip's son, doing a eulogy? I've known Philip from the time I was 15 years old. Right? That is when he first, no, 16 years old is when he first started to play dominoes at QEH Club. And that is when I met Philip, and we've been friends for all of these years. And I just want to say a few things, because what we have done is combined my eulogy with that of his wife, and I really believe that her thoughts are the thoughts that should most be conveyed to everyone here. So I will give a brief thought of mine first, and then it will share directly from the heart of Diana. Now, anybody that knows Philip will know that new Philip. We know Philip is a miserable man. Philip miserable. And Philip like to quarrel. But he don't just like to quarrel. He likes to quarrel because he likes to bring solutions, and he likes to see things done properly. And that is what I always admired about him. I remember a few years ago, well, I say in a lot of years ago, we had a three-hand team, and We used to win a lot of championships. And I would tell Philip, you are the worst captain in the world. Because Philip would just do what he want to do, how he want to do, when he want to do. Do not ask anybody anything about anything. And Philip would say, oh, we can be the best captain in the world and winning all the time. Worst captain and winning all the time. I got to be doing something right. So we can't argue, right? We just can't argue. And as a domino player, Philip has won every possible thing there is to win. He has been consistent, and he's done it with so many different partners. I won't even bother to go into all his accolades, although I have them listed here, because it would take forever, right? But he was just a champion of a man. I have a few things here. I remember, I will never forget this. When I first went to the present church that I am at, on a Father's Day, it was a Mother's Day, and the fathers had to bring, we had a session in Queen's Park, and the fathers had to bring something, bring a part of the meal, this body bring the third, and I was chosen to bring the rice. Anybody that know me know that I can't cook. So I told him I'm going to bring the rice. I picked the phone, Philip, I need a pot of rice, boy. Philip, help me out with my rice, and I presented my rice that I presented to the mothers on the day. They told me how wonderful and how lovely it was. And they told me, yes, wonderful, man, wonderful. Right? And I never let them know that it was Philip that cut my rice for me. Right? I will never forget that as long as I live. Boy. And then we also, Philip and I, we also traveled to, I think it was Jamaica, as a pair in the Jamaican tournament. We used to go down there. Now, at the point in time, I was a big, able, married man, married with children. And I'm traveling with Philip. And every day I'm telling Philip, you're not my father. Billboard, make sure you get rest. Billboard, you have something to eat. Don't go to sleep too late. Then he will come up, you're watching too much television. And I tell myself, Philip, I am a big, able man with a family and children. And Philip is treating me like I am 5 years old. But again, that was the care that Philip had for me, and I appreciated it. So we spent many long nights talking and talking and talking back and forth. And I remember, when Diana came in the picture, I will never forget. And he used to talk to me, and I used to talk to him, and then I finally met Diana, so you know he was serious. And although at that stage, believe me, my wife and I, we used to turn up with Philip House. We used to turn up with Philip House at some all ungodly hours. Philip, I hope Diana in there, you know, use a question, she's winning, not my... That's the things that I used to do. That's the relationship that we had. I used to turn up with Philip House and knock on the door. Diana will tell you the same. We've had those discussions. I hope I'm going to keep myself to myself. Right? Again, because of the care that he showed for me, I also did the same for him. And I remember when Philip was in Harrison Point. And I was calling Philip. And I spoke to Philip. And when I spoke to Philip, and I was asking how he was doing. He was, you know, man, I good. Everything, Philip. Well, I'm okay. I'm good. And he said, how the wife, you know, holding up. And he was more concerned about Diana than he was concerned about himself. So I was like, man, Philip, give me her number again. So let me go and call her and make sure that she's okay. And he never called. I did not call. And in 2 weeks, Philip was gone. And my next conversation with Diana was to offer condolences as opposed to checking up on how she was doing. And I guess that is something that I will always have to take with me, but that is enough on my side. I will share Diane's thoughts with you. Philip Nathan DeCourcy Eswick, born August 29th, 1955. He was the fourth of eight children and has two daughters, Caroline and Lisa. Six grandchildren and four great-grands. Philip grew up with his siblings in Valley View Terrace, the Pine St. Michael, before they moved to Eden Lodge, which has remained the family house up to now. Philip's elder brother, Dennis, and sister, Marlene, remember him growing up as any normal boy, but while the other children were interested in playing cricket and football, Philip gravitated to dominoes, where he excelled. Marlene recalled that Philip was homeschooled by Dennis when he was unable to attend school for about two terms, yet he passed for foundation school. Philip always spoke about how Marlene had to stop school to look after him and the younger siblings, and he would always be indebted to her for that. Now, these are direct words spoken from Philip, so to Philip. So you can view this as Diane's letter to Philip. I met Philip at the Nazarene Church where we both worship. It was 2017 and he was the president of the men's fellowship at that time. A program was ongoing for the young men at the church, Men of Valor, which was rebranded to M4M, which is Empowered for Manhood. Since I was one of the facilitators of that program, Philip and I spoke constantly about how it could come under the auspices of the men's fellowship. I remember two occasions of Philip looking back when he had a serious impression on me. One Sunday in church, while sitting in my seat, which was about four benches behind him, I noticed that he jerked suddenly and turned around and looked straight at me. I'm not sure what caused that jerk reaction, but I do recall that sometimes afterwards, the discussion shifted more about Philip and Diane than M4M. All right. Another occasion, I was driving up Government Hill, and I saw him going through that little track to his home in the Ivy. I did not blow, but it seemed as though he sensed something, so he turned right around and looked at me with that cheeky smile on his face. On my part, there was no blowing of kisses, no honking madly on the horn. I just drove in slow-moving traffic as if I did not know him. Well, as you can imagine, by the time we reached home, the phone was ringing off the hook.
Aye.
Philip and I spoke for long hours during the night. He had this habit of calling me after 11 or 12 o'clock at night and keeping me on the phone for an hour or two, causing me to always be sleepy. I recognized that that was when he came home from Domino's. He also sent me a song every day, songs I had never heard before, but which I fell in love with, even though I can't remember none now. I learned quite a bit about Philip during those times. I learned about his family, the short stint at the transport board, Barbados State and Power Company, Chickmont, where he was employed before being hospitalized, and also the first year at Bible school, which enthused him so much that he registered for the remaining 2 years to complete the diploma. And I learned, of course, about Domino's. Many times he brought up a session or a situation which I had forgotten completely. That was earlier when the church had a function and I asked him to donate some fish cakes, but then no one turned up to collect them. While I was still trying to reconcile that event in my mind, he kept saying he would make me pay for fish gates, even if it was with a slap around my head. Since he was always talking about cooking, I asked him to cut a turkey for me for a Mother's Day luncheon. See, it wasn't only me. While I collected the turkey that Saturday night, the smell was mouth-watering, but somehow I did not even taste it, and he kept asking me why I did not eat any because he had done it specially for me. I am not sure if I should have been thankful that I missed that special thing. I remember him driving my car on one occasion and it overturned. He was shaken but unhurt. To make a long story short, Philip and I became a couple after he had taken me to meet with some of his special friends. At that time, I did not know that I was being examined before he was asked to marry me. I, being a Toastmaster, spoke a lot about it, which interested him, especially when he knew that people could benefit from some of the programs, and he actually became a member of one of my clubs. Philip was extremely interested in seeing young people improve and develop themselves, as he did not receive much encouragement in this area when he was young. He organized a highly successful youth leadership program with the help of Next Generation Toastmasters Club and was amazed to see the transformation of shy young people into confident speakers. One year, Philip was invited to a program which had a number of presenters and speakers from Paradox, Sagicor Financial, and a youth pastor, etc. He had taken his two grandsons with him and they accompanied him. Being so inspired and encouraged, he told Mrs. Sharon Bushell Moore that he would be willing to partner with her in any future programs. They planned, but COVID stepped in and the plans were put aside until this year's Father's Day, when another such program was supposed to take place at the gymnasium. Unfortunately, due to Philip's bout with COVID and the long stay at Harrison's Point, the program was canceled. As president of the Men's Fellowship, he also had several sessions of Breakfast on the Beach with his young charges and was ably assisted by Charles Reed, one of the other men from the fellowship. When Philip handed over the presidency of the Men's Fellowship, he was elected to the Sunday School Board and was chosen as assistant to President Wendy Clark. Wendy aptly described Philip when she said, "Philip is a handful, but we can manage him." That description still makes me smile, especially when it was repeated by one of his colleagues from Chickmont. "Miss Wendy Clark, I want you to add, Philip is a handful, but no one can manage him. You can try to manage him as best as you can." Philip was also an assistant Sunday school teacher and a particularly good presenter. I was often chosen by the pastor to be one of the facilitators of the evangelism study sessions. He never saw himself as a preacher, but actually preached a sermon on Father's Day a couple of years back. And he was very proud of that. He came to me, but he was so excited. Philip was diagnosed with Parkinson's disease less than a year ago after attending several doctors to find out the illness that had begun to trouble him. That illness changed him in so many ways, not only in looks, but in his whole outlook on life, as he now had a team of medical personnel, including urologists, neurologists, internists, physical therapists, and nutritionists as part of his new life. He started a love for contemporary songs. I, meaning Diane, was there and saw the pain he suffered, like walking through Bridgestone one day and just toppling over because of freezing of his feet. Like sitting at the table with a Sunday meal and not knowing what to do, as when his brain does not send the right message to the appropriate organs. Like not being able to get up from bed on mornings. Like having to give up on many parts of his life because of the trembling and inability to cope. Like collapsing on one or two occasions. Like not being able to manipulate the kitchen and cook those enjoyable meals and many more things in particular. Like hiding as much as possible from COVID because he knew it would be deadly with his condition. He held on to Genesis 32, 26 and 29 and would often declare, "I will not let go unless you bless me." And his favorite saying was, "If God does not heal me, I will lay my life." I will lay my life to be a testimony. Philip's life was a testimony to the end. Even at Harrison Point, even in the hospital, Philip would constantly send out messages, constantly have things on his status, constantly encouraging people, even in his time. COVID eventually caught up with Philip And he was down at Harrison's Point for over 3 weeks. It seemed to me like a lifetime. Even though he restarted a habit of calling me around 11 at night to mornings, and in most instances, COVID left him in a debilitating condition, which necessitated him returning to QEH for medical treatment. I am thankful that at least we had 1 week while he was at QEH, although on many occasions he was unable to respond or even eat as it was feeding him or reading the Bible passages he found interesting or playing his favorite contemporary songs. If prayer alone could save Philip, he would be alive today because people worldwide were praying for him as friends and family engaged in various churches and groups in prayer for him. But God had a different plan. I did not quarrel or fight. I just accepted that it was God's plan for him at that time. Philip, I love you and I will miss you so much. Many times I cry when I want to tell you something and you are not there. Those tears started from the time you were diagnosed, but you did not know because I wanted you to know I would be strong for you as you always ask. I know you wanted so much to reach retirement at Chipmont and I did not print the rest, but because I read it 4 times and cried already, I know the rest from my head. I know you wanted so much to retire from Chipmont, but we discussed it and we decided that I would retire first so that I would be able to help you on mornings. That is dedication from a wife. I will miss Philip. I know Diane will miss Philip. I know all of us will miss Philip. I need to make a special mention of Suzette Hines in the corner, who was Philip's partner for about 1,000 years. And I know that she will greatly miss him. Philip is a good man that is gone. But the last thing that I will leave with you in my own QH Domino chat, right? I made one comment and I said, we in here, we know where Philip is. We know that Philip is a Christian. We know that Philip going to heaven. What about you? And I know that that is what Philip would want. For everyone to serve the same God, the same Jesus that he served and that was so good to him. I offer my condolences to the family and a thank you for everyone that shared their prayers. Thank you. Philip, we will miss you.
Amen. Thank you, Brother Charles, stepson of the late Philip Eswick, and thank you, Billboard Murrell, for sharing your heart, as well as Diana's heart, in your presentation of the eulogy. And Philip really was a very all-round. Yes, at first you had to get to know him. He didn't look an approachable person when you first meet him. Miserable. That's not a bad description, you know. That doesn't mean something bad in itself. It just was that way. He wanted things done a certain way, and he acted miserable to get it done. But he meant well. And once you understood him, no problem. I'm sure Donna had to learn that. And all of us had to. But he was a good friend of this church, a good friend of each one of us, the pastor. He respected me immensely. And looked out for the young people of our church. He wasn't a youth leader, but he made sure he did things or got involved in programs for their betterment, as was mentioned. Men of Valor, for instance, a youth program for the younger boys. And the youth family Toastmasters, helping young. We saw young people spoke that did not speak previously, were so shy, especially the guy that won. We were surprised and amazed. All part of what Philip sought to do, and as much as he was able. And of course, he became the men's fellowship president. So he led us men in many ways. And retreats to the beach, and programs and services here. And we really want to thank God for him. You know, one of the last things he did, I have visited him. I'm trying to remember something before, after I visited him, and, you know, he was not looking 100% there in the hospital. But I was surprised when either Chance or somebody presented his tithes. Now, no money doesn't come to me, but said, this is Philip's tithes. And I'm thinking, well, this man is sick, so sick, and yet he thinks of his church that he sends his tithe to the church. That's a good rebuke to a lot of us who have a lot to give and won't give. Amen. Sermon in itself. Thank you, Philip. You're gone from us, but you're with the Lord and certainly in a better place at this time. I was surprised when trying to find out from Diana what type of songs Philip liked. And I listening for like hymns and things like that, man of his age. But though we were the same age, basically, he was like me in his thinking. His music was elevation music. I was surprised. I went looking to see what was elevation music, gyra and things like that, but songs that we didn't really sing here. So I couldn't really pull any out of it for this occasion. But with permission from Dan and so, we chose other songs that he would have sung here. This is, for instance, Sovereign Lord is one that the men's fellowship choir would have sung. Philip didn't sing with us, as I can remember. I don't know if he sang once, maybe. But he loved what we did. And so at this time, I'm going to invite Sister Kim. And notice it says, offer to your worship. So we're offering to the Lord. Ushers, are you coming? Are you preparing? Are you in the middle somewhere and at the front? It's a big crowd. And let us give on behalf of Philip. Put yourself in Philip's shoes. On behalf of Philip, giving to the church at Carmel. You know, before this service started, a gentleman walked up to me and gave me $100. I asked him, what is it for? He says, for the church. He's not part of the service as you are. He's here, but he's not part of the service. And I really appreciate that you will care enough about Conrad Church to give. So I want to encourage you and myself that we give the best we can on behalf of the late Philip Nathaniel Eswick. Please, would you stand as we sing these songs? They're worship songs and on the multimedia. And let's worship in giving as well. Thank you so much. The ushers will guide you. I will come to the ushers. You have to come to the ushers since we don't pass around the baskets. Please come to the ushers. Thank you.
Bless the Lord. We'll sing from the projector, please. The words are wrong in the booklet. The sky and sea, created by your word, show your majesty. The stars, which you call by name, herald and proclaim that you are Lord.
Worship. especially on behalf of the late Philip, Lord, who would have loved this church and would let this church reach the higher heights. And we pray, God, even in this giving this evening, it will help us to indeed fulfill that which he would have wanted. I pray your blessings on those who would have given because they care about the church, they care about the lighthouse shining, they care about the gospel being presented through this church. And I pray, God, you will bless them and bless this act now and everything. May you get the glory, the honor, and the praise. Those who have to spend, may it be spent wisely to the glory, the honor, and the praise of your name. We bless you, Father, in Jesus' name. And all the people say, amen. You may sit and thank you, ushers, for your service of word. These ushers were in a morning's funeral, which I didn't conduct, and now they're with me again this evening. There's a body of men. I'm going to invite them, please, to come. Be in position. I want to ask Dennis Harris to please come and read the scripture lesson as found in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, 13 through 18.
The scripture lesson from 1 Thessalonians chapter 4 and verses 13 to 18. But I would not have you to be ignorant, brethren, concerning them which are asleep, that ye sorrow not, even as others which have no hope. For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so them also which sleep in Jesus will God bring with them. For this we say unto you by the word of the Lord, that we which are alive and remain unto the coming of the Lord shall not prevent them which are asleep. For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel and with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. Then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and so shall we ever be with the Lord. Wherefore, comfort one another with these words, and we say, hallelujah.
Amen. Bless God. Roger. Brother Philip did not, of himself, as I can recall, I don't recall his ever singing with us, but he would encourage us to do just that. And so at this time, we, the men's fellowship choir of this church, is going to share one of the songs that we would have sung over the years as part of the men's fellowship, of which he led for a number of years himself. It's entitled Peace.
Yeah.
I want to thank our men, and these are not all the men who can or who do sing. I'm very thankful for the willingness to come out and practice with me over the years, for that matter. We have a repertoire of songs. If you want us, you might have to pay, though. We haven't got to that point, but you know, we are always willing to minister in as much as it's allowed. I just want to take up the text for a short while that our brother read in 1 Thessalonians 4. I felt Brother read that so well that I kind of wish I had let you read it now than then. But nonetheless, it has been read. It's the word of the Lord. And the last words of that passage simply says, wherefore comfort one another with these words, the words that went before. What are those words that were spoken? The fact that, for instance, Paul said, I wouldn't have you to be ignorant concerning those, and those who he said, who are asleep. He didn't say those who die, you know. He said, those who are asleep. So when a Christian dies, and we talk about someone who has been born again, who knows Jesus Christ as the personal Lord and Savior, in whom the Spirit of God dwells, when that person lays down to sleep, they simply stay on sleeping. Amen? So that, you know, while we humanly we will weep and so forth, that's natural. Yet the Bible tells us, you do not mourn like those who have no hope. It never said not to mourn. It never said not to cry. In fact, it would be a contradiction if the Bible was to say that. No, after Jesus himself, the Bible said in John chapter 11, 12, that Jesus wept. He cried. He cried for his friend Lazarus. Of course, but the funny thing about that is that he was going to raise him again. But so, for the Christian, death is likened to sleep. And let me ask you again, as I ask all the time, when you went to sleep last night, as I assume you did, back up a little bit before you answer a question, and remember now what you read, Billboard, I try to imagine Dan and Philip, 11 and 12 o'clock, calling one and talking for so long that she got sleepy, like they are young lovers. You're human. You have feelings. You have emotions that we all do. You know, but beyond that, whether you're sleepy or not, you went to sleep, and the next thing you expected when you went to sleep was the wake up. And that's what the Bible is saying. The believer in Christ who, what we say, die, is actually waiting for the call of the Lord. As you read just now, the trump of God shall sound, the Lord shall descend, and the trump shall sound, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. Amen. Now, once there's a first, it means there has to be a second. You can't get a first by yourself. So there's going to be another resurrection. But the dead in Christ shall rise first, the living caught up with them. The other realm comes 1,000 years later for those who are not in Christ. Everybody is going to be raised eventually. You better make sure you're in what is called the first resurrection. But as Paul will go on to say, we don't have to mourn like those who have no hope. And based on what? Not philosophy, not some other theology, not simply religion, but the fact that Jesus died and rose again, amen, on the third day, amen. You know, Christianity only makes sense if there is a resurrection. If there is no resurrection, as Paul was saying in 1 Corinthians 15, man, let us eat, drink, be merry, die like the dogs, because there's no hope after this one. This is the end. But I'm here to say this evening, echoing the words of the Lord, the Apostle Paul and the others, that death is not the end for none of us for that matter, but it's not the end for the believer for sure. You know, naturally, as human beings, there is an innate fear in all of us when it comes to dying. You may not realize it at times, but you just go to the doctor and you have this excruciating pain that won't go away, but gets progressively worse. And then you are rushed to, what is it now? FMH, I don't remember what it was. You're rushed to this place. You're trying to avoid QH, you know? only to pay out a big lot of money to still get a letter to end up where? QH. And they keep you in there for a while, examining you, as the lady said to me earlier, I know the thing has a blood bank, every minute they're taking blood from me. So they do. They test it. And then one day they say to you, sir, ma'am, the news is not good. We've discovered you have a mass in the back of wherever, and we realize, based on what we've seen here, you only have a matter of months to live. You know, you might not be afraid to die, but to be told that you only got months to live, you realize, my Lord, you made all them plans, all this thing I had in mind. I plan to enjoy my retirement. Now I have to die. But death is not the end if you are in Christ. Amen. That's the beautiful thing about it. We are all going to die. But the Bible reminds us in Hebrews 9 and 27, it is appointed unto every man once to die. Now I say that with all the strength I can, with all the belief I have. I remember one day I said that here in the pulpit, and a man met me on the outside. He said, Pastor, I heard what you said, but I believe that. I said, well, what do you believe? He said, I believe in reincarnation. It would be good to know there's a reincarnation. But if I believe the Bible says, I am appointed to live and die once. After that, I have to be judged. Reincarnation means you die, and then you're reborn in another life. And you die, and then you're reborn until you reach perfection, godhood, as the case might be. If you want to believe that and take comfort that, good for you. But I believe that the Bible says, Jesus died on the cross. I will die. I will be raised. I will be judged. I believe that. Our problem is not the fact that we're going to die. We are going to die. And if we had our way, like me, who planned to die by 90, of which I have 23 more years after July, comfort them well. But always would like to live long. Get to old age, not old and doddery and all that, but old and vibrant and good grandfather, great grandmother, everybody loved me and all that. But we ain't sure we can get there. We're all going to die. We don't know when, how, where, but we're going to die. I always recall the lady who was traveling in the back of a vehicle on Barbary's Hill some years ago. You know the story. And somebody let go a shot some other place, which traveled all the way into the back of that woman's head, and she died. You don't know when, you don't know where, you don't know how, but we're all going to die, but that is not the end. In fact, it would be good in some sense that would be the end, but it's not the end. Whether you're Hitler or Paul Paul or me or you, we all have to face God in judgment, the Lord Jesus Christ himself. One day everyone is going to bow and everything is going to confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. You better be prepared for that. Get it done now so you don't have to be forced to do it then. And so, judgment is coming. Judgment is coming. I don't know how many have ever been to court. Let me relate my story one more time. The first time I was asked to attend a court, Oyston's Magistrate Court, and I went as a witness, having seen a family beating up one of them, and I went and intervened and stopped the kicking up and the beating up. He's on the ground helpless. And then he puts a charge against them and called me as a witness. Well, he's my friend. I went to be a witness. I went to court. I sat down and watched other cases going on. And then I realized in my gut, it was tight. I was nervous. I'm in court. And you don't get out, you're in court. You got to be very, very, you know, very. And then they called me as the witness. I have no problem getting in the dock. I have no problem swearing to tell the truth because I always tell the truth. And I'm there telling my truth as I saw it, not what I thought or I heard. And I'm telling it, and the lawyer for the main accused said to me, I suggest to you, but who dare he say that? You don't suggest a nervous man like me. At that point, all my nerves went. I said, no, sir. I was there, not you. Let me tell you. And so I said my piece. And when the master summed up the case, because I finished that there, he said, you know, you cannot help but believe the word of the man of the cloth, meaning Moy. Me. I spoke the truth. And the thing about judgment, when it comes to Christ's judgment, only the truth is going to prevail. There have been cases in this country and all around the world where you have, you sure that man only get 7 years? That man did such a, how he get off? And you ask all sorts of questions. But the judgment of Jesus Christ is a righteous judgment. He is going to be judge. He's going to be jury. He's going to be executioner. And boy, if your name in the Lamb's Book of Life, you're gone, as they say. We will be judged. We will die. Dying is not the problem. We will die. Judgment is what we're going to look out for. But let me say something this evening in trying to close up as well. If you know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, you can afford to attend that judgment confidently. The Bible says in Romans chapter 8, verse 1, there's therefore now in the present tense, 2022, no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus. Amen. You may be in church, but are you in Christ? You may be in the choir, but are you in Christ? You may be a servant, but are you in Christ? You may be baptized and confirmed, but are you in Christ? Are you in Christ? That's the point. If you are in Christ, you have nothing to fear. This morning, I took time with my Converse class. I hope the Converse classes who are here are doing what I asked them to do because I'm doing it too. I'm reading the Gospel of John. I'm at chapter 6 from the beginning. And in that chapter, it keeps coming up. If you believe on Jesus Christ, you have life. There will be no judgment for you. There will be no fear of the judgment. I should put it that way if I want to put it that way. And I'm saying this afternoon, death is coming, judgment is coming. But once you are in Christ, death, judgment is not something to fear. But you can look forward to hear the Lord say, well done, good and faithful servant. Enter thou into the Lord, joy of thy Lord. That's what we look forward to. What are you doing with your life this evening? I heard the eulogist in conclusion made the point that Philip would want everybody to know the Lord. That's so true. That's so true. That's so true. You're here this evening for another funeral. And you will leave here eventually. But do you know the Lord Jesus Christ? I know a lot of people tell me I pray and I believe them too. And I talk to the Father and I believe that too. Because they said it. But let me say, and I keep telling them, if you've passed the Son, you've missed the whole thing. Do you know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior? You know, I will preach and give my heart here in these services. About 2 years ago on Westbury Cemetery at a graveside funeral, a man walked to me and said to me, Pastor Holy, you really don't know me. I didn't. He said, I've been to several funerals in which you spoke. He said, every time I left your funeral, I am always troubled. I would wish to God that everybody could be troubled who is saved. And that's not to put you down anywhere. That's just to make you think about yourself. He said, but Pastor, I want you to know that now as I speak with you, I have gone and given my life to Christ. I'm no longer troubled. I have the peace of God. I know the forgiveness of God. You can have that too. That is what it's all about. It's not just with several man who's died or is now with the Lord. But your life is the important thing because you're not going to live. Are you going to live for the Lord or for yourself? For the dominoes or for yourself? For whatever, for yourself? What, who are you living for? That's the issue. It's good to have this hope. Every man that have this hope keeps himself pure. What hope do you have? Some of us put hopes in man, meaning male man, and in woman. And today we are bitter, angry, cussing that dog that messed up my life. You know how you put it? In other words, some of us are happily married, doo-doo darling, sweetest thing besides sweet bread and honey. And now he's a dog and she's a whatever. You know what I'm saying? You put hopes in politicians. You put hopes, unfortunately, even in pastors, and we've let you down too. But I want you to know there's a hope in Jesus Christ, a hope that will not fail you, can sustain you when sickness, or don't matter what the need of sickness, when danger, when problems come, a hope that only God can give. And if you know Jesus Christ, you can have this hope now in the present tense. And may I say amen? Would you say amen with me? Amen. I need no other argument. I need no other plea. It is enough that Jesus died and that he died for me. And so, Father, I commit this congregation into your hands and give thanks for every man, woman, boy, or girl sitting or standing here today. I'm sure in some way, Lord, you would have found somewhere to speak to somebody. to remind somebody that they were once in church, that they were once saved, that they were once walking right, that they promised when they were sick to serve you, that they promised when things were bad, they will serve you when you make it better, and you have done so. You've kept your side. You so love us, oh God, that you gave your son to die for us. And now all you ask us to do is to take that son as our Savior and Lord. And so I pray, God, somebody here this evening, right where they sit or stand, will cry unto you and say, Lord, be merciful to me, a sinner. And surely, as I read very well this morning, Jesus said, none that come to me, I will in no wise cast out. So it doesn't matter how bad we are, or how bad we were, with whom we've been, or what we did with whatever. Lord, if we come now, the blood of Jesus Christ can cleanse us of all sin. So I commit this congregation and all of us into your hands. As we prepare, oh God, to leave here to go on to yonder cemetery, go with us and keep us in your perfect peace. And again, for this family, we lift them before you, that your peace, that passive understanding, that your joy becomes their strength, that your love will abound in their hearts, that they will unify together and work together. Philip is gone, but may they cherish each other, because who knows who's next. And for all of us, Lord, in these solemn moments, may we think of eternity. This is not the only life. This is not all there is. There's a greater glory. There's a greater glory. Eyes have not seen, says your word. Ears have not heard the things that God has prepared for those that love him. I pray somebody will get to love you now and experience that joy now and that glory later. In the name of Jesus, I pray. Amen. Let's stand. Paul bears preparing immediately. I would normally come down and say something. I won't have to do that this time. We're just going to sing the song. Brother David is going to... No, I'm sorry, Sister Kim, you think you have to lead us in this one. I stand amazed in the presence of Jesus the Nazarene. I wonder how he could love me, a sinner condemned unclean. For me it was in the garden he prayed, not my will but thine. He had no taste for his own grief, but sweat drops of blood for mine. Paul Bears, are we ready?
Jesus the Nazarene, and wonder. didn't know today would be your last, or that I'd have to say goodbye to you so fast. I'm so numb I can't feel anymore. I'm praying you just walk back through that door and tell me that I was only dreaming. You're not really gone as long as I believe. There will be another angel around the throne tonight. Love lives on inside of me, and I will hold on tight. It's not my place to question, only God knows why. I'm just jealous of the angels around the throne tonight. Made my troubles feel so small, and you were always there to catch me when I'd fall. In a world where heroes come and go, well, God just took the only one I know. So I'll hold you as close as I can, longing for the day when I see your face again. But until then, God must need another angel around the throne tonight. Your love lives on inside I will hold on tight. It's not my place to question, only God knows why. I'm just jealous of the angels around the throne tonight, singing hallelujah. Didn't know today would be your last, or that I'd have to say goodbye to you so fast. I'm so numb I can't feel anymore. I'm praying you just walk back through that door and tell me that I was only dreaming. You're not really gone I believe there will be another angel around the throne tonight. Your love lives on inside of me, and I will hold on tight. It's not my place to question, only God knows why. I'm just jealous of the angels around the throne tonight. Always made my troubles feel so small, and you were always there to catch me when I'd fall. In a world where heroes come and go, where God just took the only one I know. So I'll hold you as close as I can, longing for the day when I see your face again. But until then, God must need another angel around the throne tonight. Your love lives on inside of me, and I will hold on tight. It's not my place to question, only God knows why. I'm just jealous of the angels around the throne tonight, singing hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Just jealous of the angels around the throne tonight.
Thank you.
Testing. Your undivided attention, ladies and gentlemen. I know that my Redeemer liveth, and that he shall stand at the latter day upon the earth. And though after my skin worms destroy this body, yet in my flesh shall I see God, whom I shall see for myself, and my eyes shall behold, and not another. Then I heard a voice from heaven saying unto me, write, blessed are, I'm sorry, let me read it again. We're in a different version, so sorry about that. Then I heard a voice from heaven say, write this, blessed are the dead who die in the Lord from now on. Yes, says the Spirit, they will rest from their labors, for their work, their deeds will follow them. Revelation 14, 13. For as much as the spirit of our departed loved brother has returned to God who gave it, we therefore commit his body to the ground, earth to earth, ashes to ashes, dust to dust. In the true and certain hope of the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come through our Lord Jesus Christ, who gave to us new bodies like unto his glorious body, blessed are the dead who die in the Lord. Amen. Could we all say the Lord's Prayer together, everyone? Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Amen. Okay, we don't let that young man be free. He's a part of the family. Yes. Grandson who feels it very keenly. They're afraid he will go into home.
I am going home. Quiet lights song still there. I'll be going home. It's not far, just close by.
be mindful of the graveside songs. Precious Lord, take my hand soon and very soon. When the rose call up yonder. Those are the three. The last song is reserved for after the flowers are placed and the benediction. Perchance you run out of songs after the first three. You can raise from Amazing Grace to It Is Well, or go back to the one in the church. But there are several songs that are well known at funerals. We are accompanied, but we have to sing. Precious Lord, everyone. Precious Lord, take my hand. Lead me on, help me stand. I am tired, I am weak, I am worn. Through the storm, through the night, lead me on to the light. Take my hand. Precious Lord, lead me home. When my way grows dread, precious Lord, linger near. When my life is over,
you are enough.
I will be running in this right now, in every circle. Is running after me. With my life left, I'm surrendered now. I give you everything. His goodness is running out. Is running out. I surrendered now, give you everything. Your goodness is running out, is running out to me.
Us to worship God for just a moment. We talked about one sound. Everybody say one sound. There is a kingdom sound. There is a kingdom sound. Everybody say that. There is a kingdom sound. Say it again. There is a kingdom sound. And I want you to understand this, that there is always a sound that precedes a move of God. Everybody say that. There's always a sound that precedes the move of God. Whenever you will find deliverance, wherever you will find healing, wherever you find a move of God, it is always associated with a sound. I want us to take just maybe 30 seconds, and we're gonna sing this song. We're gonna raise it as an offering to the Lord. But I want us to take about maybe just 30 seconds, if you will. Brother, I just want you to minister on that guitar.
We're just having the benediction at this time, and then the final song. There's my choir on my right. All of you get ready to sing, and God will take care of you after the benediction. And now to the family and all others, the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord mercifully and graciously cause his face to shine upon you. May the Lord lift up the light of his countenance upon you, granting to each of one of you his grace, peace, mercies, and blessings through Jesus Christ our Lord. And let all the people on the ground say, Amen. I wish Diana and all family members a good afternoon, but better tomorrow with God's help. God be with you. Philip is gone, but God remains. And of course, I'm here for you as well as others. God bless you. God will take care of you. The last song, good old song. Family. Be not dismayed, what a bitter. God will take care of you. Beneath his wings of love, bye-bye. God will take care of you. God will take care of you. Thank you, right hand side. On the left hand side, you can raise yours too. He will take care of you. God will take care of you. Through days of time, death, fear, God will take care of you. When dangers face your path, God will take care of you. God will take care of you through every day, all the way. He will take care of you. God will take care of you. No matter what may be the test. God will take care of you. Lean weary one upon his breast. God will take care of you. Oh, God will take care of you. God will take care of you. Yes, thank you so much. So thank you at this time. Just listen attentively.
Good evening to all. I want to express thank you to all friends and family who have taken the opportunity to come and say the last farewell to Philip. I know there have been many prayers, many songs that you have sent, good wishes, and just calling and giving me encouragement, letting me know that you are praying for me. Even before Philip died, letting us know that you were praying for us. And as Bill Gore said in eulogy, if prayers could have saved Philip, he would be alive today. But it was God's will. And I do believe, and I believe some of you know, that he's in a better place. So I have no quarrel with that. The last week at the hospital was not very good for him, and he's out of his suffering now. But you care, and you're here, and I thank you for coming. All his friends, his family members, continue to uphold us in your prayers, and continue to think of Philip. He may be gone, but his memory should live on in yours. So again, I thank you, and I wish you well as you go to your various places. Thank you.
We wish you well as well. Amen. That concludes the service. Thank you. God bless all of you.
You did not wait for me to draw nigh to you, but you clothed yourself in frail humanity. To cry out to you, but you let me hear your voice calling me. But you let me